Sickle cell disease is one of the most devastating diseases that we see in hematology. One of the hallmarks of the disease is pain, and it can be pain that may start mild but can become very severe, requiring hospital admission for days or even sometimes weeks. It's very disruptive to the patient and their family's lives.
Sickle cell disease is a genetic disease in which the normal hemoglobin that's in the red blood cell, the function of which is to carry oxygen, has a protein mutation that makes the red cell turn into a sickle shape. And when that happens, it causes the oxygen not to be delivered to vital organs.
Well, fetal hemoglobin has been sort of the focus of the sort of red cell biology field for more than 50 years. Fetal hemoglobin is very protective in sickle cell disease, really for two reasons. One, it replaces the sickle hemoglobin itself, but it also, importantly, blocks the sickling process. And when the fetal hemoglobin at birth is high enough, hasn't fully come down, children are well, and then around 3 to 6 months of age, when fetal hemoglobin has decreased to almost the adult level, that's when the symptoms appear. And what we really wanted to understand was, what's the basis of that? What's the mechanism? And then if we knew the mechanism, could we do anything about it? Could we use that information to design a therapy?
What controlled that switch from fetal to adult hemoglobin was really unknown. And so at the time we started this work about 20 years ago, we wanted to try to figure out, is there a specific regulator of this process? And so we failed a lot. We spent a lot of energy trying to figure out, okay, are there ways to get at this problem? But we were able to identify a key regulator of this process, BCL11A. When it's well expressed, which is happening in all of our cells right now in our bone marrow, it suppresses the production of fetal hemoglobin, and we mostly produce adult hemoglobin. And when it's turned down, we can actually induce more fetal hemoglobin. And that's essentially what the therapies are trying to do. They're trying to reverse that switch by turning down BCL11A and turning up the fetal hemoglobin molecule.
And right around that time, in 2012 and 2013, the first reports started coming out about a new gene editing system called CRISPR. And the results were really remarkable, that using CRISPR, we could make very efficient genetic changes at our target sequence, which was at the BCL11A gene, and lead to the effects that we were hoping to see, which was red blood cells that could make high levels of fetal hemoglobin, but other blood functions were preserved. In 2015, we published a paper where we had used the CRISPR system to define the specific sequences that could be targeted for therapy, we thought. And in fact, a company took those sequences forward, did clinical trials, and ultimately received FDA approval in patients with sickle cell disease and beta thalassemia. And so now those therapies are available to patients with those diseases.
The reason to travel to Boston Children's for gene therapy is we have the most experience. We have created an amazing program here, and I'm thrilled to be part of it. We were the lead site in doing the clinical research, and we created the care model that these treatments are now delivered through. We have a multidisciplinary approach with our treatment program. Anybody who may have any interaction with the patient is involved in our care team. It's patient first. Once they get in with us, they get through the process, they get the gene therapy, and then they start feeling better. For some patients, it's life-changing. If you're comfortable and you're not in pain, you have your life back. You can plan for your future.
I never felt good enough to even try to work a job. I was just so in and out of the hospital, I couldn't even do that, even at home. Now I feel like I'm good like health-wise, I'm like, I feel like I'm perfect.
I think having new approved therapies for people with sickle cell is infusing hope into patients and families and those of us who take care of people with this disease. The new treatments for sickle cell derived from a lot of the science here at Boston Children's. So it's very exciting to see that translational research happen in real life.
It's incredibly inspiring to see that work that now we did 15 years ago has now led to an FDA-approved therapy. And that's incredibly satisfying. And so I think it's the first step of hopefully many steps. And I think it'll also hopefully serve as a model for how we might be able to address other blood diseases that impact so many of our patients.
It's kind of remarkable, as I look back, what we can do now. I mean, when we started, we couldn't clone genes. We hardly knew what a gene was. We couldn't express the genes. And now we have the capability of modifying them. It's been an amazing sort of ride, and there'll be other landmarks going forward.
I'm really excited about building from what we already have to developing next generation therapies that can be easier, less toxic, and simpler to deliver.
That's, I think, what actually motivates us, what gets us up every morning to come in, because we want to do something that hasn't been done before.